Ladies and gentlemen, Joe Decuir.
My wife said, "You gotta come down." He said, "This is your tribe. You should be there." Now, I retired forcibly last October because the Qualcomm bought my company, and then they laid off 50% of their staff, including me. But I was ready for a sabbatical anyway. In November, my wife was diagnosed with metastatic ovarian cancer. I hope nobody that you're associated with ever gets this, because it's normally a death sentence. So since I became retired, I've spent 90% of my time supporting my dear wife. Fortunately, she's going to live. And so I got invited to come on down here, and she said, "Yes, you should go." So I'm here. So I wrote this particular slide deck for this crowd. I have been giving public lectures around the world for at least 25 years, maybe longer. And I used to be a technical evangelist at Microsoft, mixing the Kool-Aid and giving it out. So I sort of speak PowerPoint. Currently, I am an IEEE fellow, and you will say, "What the hell is that? Are you a nice guy?" But in fact, IEEE has 430,000 members worldwide. They're the world's largest technical professional society. Half of them are in North America, half of them are outside of North America. Every year, 300 people are made fellows, which is the highest membership grade. And I submitted based on the Atari 2600, the Atari computer, and the Amiga. I was promoted to fellow the first time. And the cool thing about being a fellow is I dropped out of the PhD program at Berkeley in 1981 after I left Atari. And I wanted to, as my retirement encore career, teach college engineering. And the cool thing, University of Washington will treat fellow as more than equivalent to a PhD. So I've applied for a part-time teaching position this fall. I'll probably get it. The faculty has already voted to allow me to join the faculty. I have to get through the HR people. Anyway, that's one of my two encore career jobs. The other one is playing in a rock band. I have, see this blister on my finger?
You play bass?
Yes. That's how I got it. The Western United States is Region 6. I'm the secretary. I'm on the Consumer Electronics Society Board of Governors, hence the logos. And there's a conference, Global Humanitarian Technology Conference, that's happening again this October. I was the chairman last October and the vice chair the year before. What's that about? Half the planet lives on $2 a day or less. And IEEE is committed to advancing technology for humanity. And that means not just first world people, but people who are currently third world. And if a disaster happens, we're all third world. Right? We all live in the Northwest. The chances of a magnitude 8 or larger earthquake on the Cascadia subduction zone are 38% in the next 50 years. So in my lifetime, there's probably 20-30% chance of one of those. Right? That happens here. We're all third world for months. Months. The conference is about responding to disasters, amongst other things. Those are my IEEE positions. Bass player is not there. Next slide. Okay, so what do I want to talk about? So, how did I get prepared for that wonderful, fun career? What have I worked on, so what do I know about? I have three projects that I'm working on thinking about that impact the retro game world. And one of them is a book to write on the Atari computers. One of them is perhaps coming up with an FPGA-based hardware implementation. And I want to get the classic game experience on new hardware. And I have the inventory that I've got now in my lab, take a lot of questions, and I have some resources, some of which are over on this table. Capiche? Next. Okay. How did I get ready? And what do I know about it? At least from a technical standpoint. Next. Okay, so I was really lucky. As my son puts it, I come from geek royalty. My father worked on nuclear weapons in World War II as a test engineer. He did stuff that ended up over in Nagasaki and Trinity. I had skill and I was persistent. I went to Berkeley. I wedged almost 5 years of classes into 4 years and then spent some more time getting a master's degree. I learned engineering pre-med, and I was active in the student cooperatives in Berkeley. So I learned how to manage a whole bunch of people and get a lot of stuff done with collections of people when most people have no idea how to get do their own work, let alone manage other people. So I worked my way through school because my father got laid off at his job. I always chose jobs that would teach me a lot. When I counsel young engineers on how to have great careers, first criteria, choose jobs that will teach you stuff you don't already know, because you never know enough. And whatever you do know is going to become obsolete. Second, choose jobs that will connect you well in your industry. Because if you got jobs to offer, go through your network first. And if you need a job, find them through your network, which is how I got the Atari job. Come back a second. Okay, and then how did I get that Atari job? Next slide, perfect. Okay, I had studied microprocessors at Berkeley. I actually took a class on using the 4004, if any of you have ever heard of those. Really ancient. And when Byte Magazine came out in September of 1975, I got the charter issue. Someone stole it from me, but I still have most of the old bytes in the first several years. I was working in medical research. I was not working in that trade in the fall of 1975, but I was reading a lot and educating myself on a lot of other stuff. There was a conference called WestCon, Western Electronics Show and Convention. It used to go between Los Angeles and San Francisco Bay Area every year. And they had a WestCon in San Francisco in Moscone Center in September of 1975. And along came the MOS 6502. I went in there and I bought one. I still have it somewhere in a box in my garage, along with the hardware and the software manuals. And then I bought a Kim. And I did this before I started looking for another job. But in October of that year, my medical electronics group laid me off. They said, we've run out of money. You have 2 months to go find another job. So I had to go find another job. And I had been educating myself on it, which means that through my network, I found mutual friends. I passed a technical interview. I didn't know that they were aware of that processor, but I was really up on it. And that was great. And then I went to the lobby and they had a whole bunch of Atari coin-op games. And I thought, I'm being tested. And what I didn't put on there, but as luck would have it, that summer, I'm 24, my youngest brother is 12. We're walking down the street in Disneyland in Anaheim. And there's some funny noises off the side. We go in, it's an arcade. And there is an Atari coin-op tank game. We burn a lot of quarters on that Atari tank game. My brother beats me. He's got better reflexes. But we wasted a bunch of money for me to learn to play tank so that when I was interviewed, I passed the interview. So, and I chose the job. I was offered two jobs, one in medical electronics and one at Atari. And the one at the medical electronics moved to Orange County, and I was going to be their expert in microprocessors. Whereas if I went to Atari, I was going to learn how to design custom chips. So I chose the job that would give me more stuff rather than being the expert. So that's how I got there. Next. So, here is, in my opinion, the definitive social history of Atari at the time, of the incorporated version. This one ends in 1984. And that's a picture of me that's in that book when I had more hair and I weighed less. I actually didn't have family yet. This is, we had done wire wrap prototypes of all the chips that were in there. And this is basically, that's actually not an Atari, that's an ASR, that's a terminal, video terminal. Talk to this thing, right, in a Comemco chassis. A friend of mine who lives and works in Boston has one in his garage somewhere. And if I can get my hands on it, I want to get my hands on his copy of the whole thing. Of course, it's wire wrap, which means it probably doesn't work. Because, you have to rewind those once in a while or they get loose. But anyway, that's me from the time. Next. Okay, so here's what I got to work on in the last 40-some years. I left off the medical stuff. But I got to work at Atari on a couple of machines, which you've heard of by now, and then the Amiga. I did a lot of modems because I had realized that we were going to wind up moving towards communications. So I started a modem company with some friends of mine and did a lot of that. And a larger company, Everett, bought us out, so we shipped lots and lots of modems. That company went out of business, and Microsoft hired me, so I moved up to Seattle area and became program manager for networking components in Windows, shipped lots of versions of Windows, up through XP. I worked on public standards. So we wired up the internet with all those modems back in the 80s and 90s. That's where I met Kenny. Designed and then standardized fax modems. I worked on how to hook second generation cellular into Windows. Worked on USB, both how USB itself works and then how the communications class drivers work. I've got patents that haven't expired yet on how it works. I worked in ultra wideband when we were still trying to get wireless USB to work, and I've spent most of the last 10 years working on variations of Bluetooth. So, a lot about that. And all my patents on all that stuff, they're all expired. Anyway, and yeah, I made Fellow, which is cool. Next. All right, any questions about the first stuff? Okay. Okay. I've got three ideas for things that might interest people in the retro game world, and the first one is write a book. So, there is, I recommend this book written by historians on how the 2600 works. And I recommend this book if you want to know how the Amiga works, except it doesn't go into much detail about the hardware because they didn't know the stuff, because the hardware designers were gone by the time they hired all the software people, who did a great job, but I didn't get to meet them. So I want to write the book here on the computers. And I want it, that's a tentative title, I would want it to be a three-part story. For those of you familiar with the stories, a lot of them have three acts. So the first act begins with, what did we learn when we shipped the video game? Or at least, what lessons did we take from it? Which isn't necessarily what the lessons were. A lot of it's in the eye of the beholder. So, all the way through to completing the design, which is hardware architecture, hardware systems, hardware details, system schematic, thank you for loaning me that. The built-in operating system, the BIOS, the extended operating system on disk, a whole bunch of applications, not to mention the games. And the third is, or the second part is, applications. I would like to not only talk about the development of the built-in software in the system, I have some sources for some of the non-game applications. A friend of mine from the CES board is the guy who wrote VisiCalc for it. He's the guy with that stuff back in Boston. And he still remembers what he did. And I want to talk about how you write games on it, as well as productivity applications. I'll get a detail that's worth mentioning here. How many of you know about the Atari game Adventure? I would think most of you do. There's actually a chapter on it in this book. I got reacquainted with Warren Robinette a small number of years ago, and we've been corresponding ever since. He's writing a book called The Annotated Adventure, and he explains how it works. And with his permission and cooperation, I want to sort of re-implement the game on the Atari computer. Why? Way more powerful. I could make, dragons that don't look like ducks. I could make an avatar that looks like Link or, something relatively humanoid rather than a square. The bat would probably still look like a bat, but that sort of thing. Plus, it was really innovative what he did of having a big virtual world and you jump from one to the next, but on the computer version, I could build a big virtual world. Your avatar stays still in the middle all the time. The entire rest of the world moves smoothly depending on where you move. So the joystick will control what the screen does, not what your avatar does. Right? So that requires me to write applications, games. I'll write some demos, too. And then I want to go through the product history. There were all the things that we did when we were still Atari Inc. Then there was a big collapse and rearrangement, and there was Atari Corp. They had products. And there's still ongoing support. Atari A supports development. People I've talked to here do development. Atari Max is building gadgets. And Lotharac is building gadgets that support the ongoing. It's kind of amazing that people are still doing this stuff, but I want to cover that too. And at the end of this, of course, I would say, what did we learn from that machine, which animated what we thought of that became the Amiga? Although, of course, we wanted Amiga to build it. I'm sorry, we wanted Atari to build it, but Atari fell apart. So we had to go do something else later. Anyway, that's what I want to do. Now, help I need from guys here. People here have expertise in using some of those tools. People here know lots and lots of people for me to talk to as a historian. And I need to go find them. For example, Bill Wilkinson. There are a whole lot of people named Bill Wilkinson. You probably know the right one. Good. Okay, next. All right, so here's what they look like. Those books. Next. Here is something from, where'd it go? You've already scanned this, right?
Yes.
Right.
Sorry, archives.org.
Right. That's in this notebook. Next. Here is, pirated from Chris Crawford, the insides of the 400-800. Some of you are familiar with this. The old 800s had a left and right cart. The newer ones only have one cartridge slot. Anyway, rest of the system, next. For those of you unfamiliar with it, here's the insides of the Amiga. 68K Agnes data chip and non-video I.O. chip. They had different names at different times and lots of memory. Questions about these? Yes, sir.
The designs are awfully similar. That's the support chips.
Well, here's why. Go back one. Okay? Go back two. All right. No, not quite. All right. This system has no ROM in the motherboard at all. The cartridge completely defines what happens. There is no operating system. When people wrote code, they would trade code with each other. Like I wrote Compute Horizontal Reset when I made Combat working, and almost everybody used Compute Horizontal Reset. You know, but that's like, you know, trading viruses in kindergarten. So there's a chip that does, you know, video and audio. And here's a chip that combines the only memory in this, only RAM in the system, 1,000 bits, you know, some I.O. and a timer. Really simple. And most, in fact, there's no interrupts in the system. There's only one level of code. So there's only two processes. There's the vertical blank code and the non-vertical blank code. That's it. It's all driver. So going forward to the next slide, we thought, okay, here's how fast processors are now. Here's what they can do in a software-intensive way. Our general attitude was, let's move a lot of new functionality into the I.O. system and or parallel processing so that more you get more end-user value if the system is more interesting to listen to or look at, okay? So, in this system, we had a second machine that generates addresses, and it generates lots of addresses. It does DRAM refresh. It runs all the video that then pokes data into this data out chip. And we partitioned it into three pieces for two reasons. These are closely related to each other, so we had to carefully define how much information we have to pass from one chip to the next. Because we only had 40-pin packages. You know, modern chips have several hundred packages, you know, pins. We were at 40. That was new at the time. And so this does all the address generation for character maps and bit maps and whatnot. And then pours the data. It would send out a signal so that this thing would capture the data when this thing generated the address. So this is a pair working together. And then we sorted all the non-video I.O. into the third chip, which did potentiometers, keyboard scanning, and disk drives and serial bus. Okay. That's what we did. So, given that general architecture, next slide, same idea. Two parts closely together. This one generates all the addresses to memory, and then this thing grabs the stuff that this thing sends out. In fact, this is fairly explicit. This can drive an 8-bit address separately from the main memory address, so this thing can go grab something from memory as the source, and then it can say to which one of these things send out an address decode, which of you needs to grab the data that's on the bus. So, in this system, Again, address unit, video output, audio is a separate part as it was before, non-video. And these things, the chips couldn't be much larger. We were looking at maybe 48 pins versus 40 pins. But you got big limits on the number of pins. And in the two systems, we went from an 8-bit data bus to a 16-bit data bus, which means you ate up all the extra pins. Anyway, so that's where that came from.
At what point in the Amiga's development, and it was my understanding that the sound chip was the last thing to be done?
Well, from a logical standpoint, yeah, but we knew we wanted great sound. We know we wanted much better sound than we got in the Atari computers. And so...
Can you shed some light on that development of the call?
I need to... There's a separate... Both the Atari computer and the Amiga have four channels simultaneously. In the Atari computers, we basically took what was in the Atari video game and kind of scaled it up. It still did noise and not noise, and you could plug in various devices in them so you could do what they now call pokey sound, right? This is much more elaborate. We generate a top clock, but the top clock is not only sets the sample rate, but there's another set of pointers for determining where the memory image of the sound will come from and how long that image is. So basically it's you can think of it as a sampler. Each audio engine can sample a 4-kilobit piece of memory as 8-bit samples. So one of the demos that we did is we got the dog to bark, Mitchie. And then they saved that as a sample and they hooked it up to a keyboard. So if you push it here, it's a woof, and if you push it here, it's a yip, and if you push it here, it's dog barks in various frequencies. It was just hilarious.
What did Mitchie think of that when you played it back?
Didn't care. Anyway, so it's a 16-bit oriented system, so if you pick the sample length of one word, it'll just get, here's a note, and here's the other note, and here's the note, so you'll get a square wave. If you want to do a decent job of digitizing a sine wave, you know, 16 samples is plenty for low enough harmonic distortion. If you want to digitize a sine wave chord, you know, like say a C and an E and a G, you know, first, third, and fifth, 60 samples is sufficient to have all of them justly tuned in one image, add them all up. So you can play a chord, you know, three-note major chord in one sample, and then you can change its frequency and do whatever you want with it. So we were imagining that you could have a drum kit on one channel, and the bass lick on another channel, and the rhythm lick on a third channel, and then something that's the sound, the melody or the singing on a fourth channel in one system. Now, I have been waiting for 30 years to play with this hardware. Something that's not on the list of things I want to do is find some old Amiga sound composition stuff and start fooling with this hardware, because I took it to the point of a design. I didn't get to actually build it, let alone use it for fun. But yeah, that's what I want to do. So go to the next slide. So, use cases, yeah, four independent channels, an audio can be a sine wave, anything. Pseudorandoms can just be another random waveform that you store. A musical image can be sampled and played back like the one with the dog. You can make three note chords. Next slide. So that's actually what the Amiga audio subsystem looks like. Anyway, so escape out of that, and let's go back to the slide deck. I think I more than answered your question.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Right, one, click it here. This one. No, no, you want that. That! Come on. Yes, okay. Three system diagrams. Next slide. Okay, so for the book, I've been a first-person contributor, written, you know, 10,000 words plus a bunch of diagrams. And I sent it off to the MIT Press people, and they said, we're going to send it to the other authors, and by the way, we think that you need help as a historian, as opposed to as a first-person contributor. So I recruited Marty. Marty and Kurt wrote that social history, to go and find all the people that you know about. Actually, I know some, and I don't know some. They've written a book that's on the table there. Yeah, that's the one. And they're working on another one on Atari Corp, Business is War. Anyway, so I gotta be a historian. These are people that I'm in contact with. I know where he lives, I know what his phone number is, he doesn't answer his phone. I know all these other people, I've talked to all of them in the last year, except Ihor Wolosenko. I haven't talked to him for 2 years. But yeah, I know where to find those people. Next slide. I really want to find Scott, because he's one of the architects of SIO, and he designed the code in the 850. You know what the 850 is. I'd like to find Howard. I don't. A lot of these people, they're either not on LinkedIn, or there's several dozen people with Bill Wilkins.
I don't want to derail your talk, but Bill died last year.
Oh!
You just derailed it.
That's all right.
Hopefully he's left enough stuff around on the web. But okay.
Sorry.
All right. I want to find the people that I can find. I don't know if Francois Michel moved back to France or not. And I have no idea how to find George McLeod. He designed the CTI and the GTI. Francois did the logic design of the engine. I want to see how many of these people I can find, and I'm sorry for that.
I'll attack this list. I haven't looked for some of these names. I have looked for William Robinson. I haven't been able to find him, but...
Okay. All right. Anyway, yeah. I'd like to find... I'll document as much as I can document. Next slide. Okay. Second thing in the middle of the book. So, I want to demonstrate some features. Like, I wrote a demo a long time ago, and I poked it all in BASIC. I called it scrolling ducks. It basically has ducks that are moving sideways, and some that are moving 45 degrees, and some that are moving straight down. And it runs continuously. It's pretty silly but fun. I could probably demonstrate it here the next time I come visit. Lots of players at once. So, for example, the system has four 8-bit sprites rather than two. And so I wrote the original version of Combat. I could easily create a four-player version of Combat that you'd play on the one with the original four game controllers. Easy. Just to show how it's done. And then I'm talking to Warren about porting, making a new game on this. What I want to produce is source code and playable objects on a website so that people can download it and play it. I would make it open source, you know, GNU license, if anything. Right? If you change it, just post the results. I want to encourage open source development on these retro game systems. I'm not trying to make a living off of this. Somebody else might want to, but I don't care. For me, it's a labor of love, basically. Next slide. Okay. That's the book. Second project, lower priority is I've been thinking for years about what would it take to put together a mini PCS. Now, when I was last designing hardware 20-some years ago, we didn't have FPGAs. FPGAs are wonderful. I need to learn how to use them. Next slide. So, for Atari game implementations, there's an emulator like Stella. It runs on PCs. There's a Flashback 2.0, which is based on an FPGA. I now own the prototype of that. And people have emulated on other systems. So the Flashback 5, it's all an emulator running over Linux embedded system. For the Atari PCS, people have built at least one software implementation of it, but I haven't tested any of them yet. According to Kurt Vandell, he's got access to a lot of the hardware for the inside of the system. And when I digitize that, I can make sure that there is Verilog equivalent of the main schematic. And I've heard rumors that it might be able to run on that MIST platform that people are talking about that I've ordered. There are two Amiga implementations. One of them is the MIST that implements the Minimake open source hardware. And people have built a bunch of PC software emulators of the Amiga. Right? So for those of you who want to do retro game things now, you can emulate it on something else. You can have hardware that does it. And that's if you don't have the original hardware that still works. Like, I have three Amiga 2000s and one of them doesn't work because I need to replace the batteries and clean up everything carefully first. Next slide. So, what would a mini PCS have? Obviously, it needs to run the original software. It needs at least two game controller ports on it. It doesn't have to have four, but it could.
You gotta play Mule, you need four, sir.
What?
You wanna play Mule, you need four, sir, for Mule.
Well, okay.
Four.
I'll get there how we do that. Needs video out. It could have be just RCA video, like the Flashbacks, or it could be HDMI, like the new modern computers. I got, just 2 weeks ago, I bought, but haven't yet installed, a Raspberry Pi 3, which is quad core, and it's got HDMI out. Right?
It has composite too.
What?
It has composite as well.
Okay.
You do have through the headset jack, except for in your okay.
So interesting options for such a system would be SD drive emulation, basically what the Lotharex stuff does. USB only extended Atari BIOS, because it knows logically about them and it's just way faster. So if you had a USB interface part that could run slow enough to talk to an old processor, it would be interesting to think about Wi-Fi networking. It'd be interesting to think about Bluetooth HID I/O. I need to figure out what the Flashback 5 actually does, because the game controllers are actually wireless. And they might already be Bluetooth, for all I know. But I have to reverse engineer them. Next slide. Okay. Going even farther, you can do 80-column video. Does anybody have an 80-column card here in this room?
Not with me, but no, yes.
Well, people worked on 80-column video for the 1090.
Yeah.
One of the things I didn't put in the slide deck, as a consultant in early 1984, my business partner and I worked on a serial parallel card and an internal modem card for the 1090. Now, Jack bought the company, all that stuff was canceled, but we at least got our money back a year later. But those things existed. I have schematics somewhere, but I don't know that anyone actually cares about them. But things have gone so much farther, I can't think of wanting to put modems in them now. People do Wi-Fi. You can do better audio. But then I think to myself, hey, I just ordered from the Lotharek guy the Amiga 500 Mist FPGA machine, which I mentioned later in the slide deck. And it does a lot of that stuff. And I'm thinking, why would I want to add that to the Atari design? Because I can buy it from Amiga and play with it that way. So I'm not going to put a lot of time into that. But the earlier, the previous feature set is still interesting. It's lower priority than the book, but it's interesting to me. Question I would ask right now is there anybody here who cares? If you could get one of those things, would you use it? And if so, what would you use it for?
Absolutely. This hardware, as you know, is not going to last forever.
Mm-hmm.
It decays, it breaks.
Mm-hmm.
And to be able to buy a thing that has the same functionality and yet will last, you know, starting its new life cycle, that's pretty important.
Right. And to me, the really interesting thing is these machines are simple enough that people can roll their own applications, make up new stuff, or take existing applications and start modifying them in new and interesting ways. To me, they're, as all these machines were, these are artists' canvases.
Mm-hmm.
These are making a new medium for people to do art. How many of you have ever heard of the Smithsonian exhibit called Art of the Video Game? At least one. Okay, I was lucky. 4 years ago, a friend of mine was in D.C., and he was wandering through the Smithsonian Portrait Gallery, and he found Art of the Video Game. It was a 9-month show. So I saved my frequent flyer miles and my hotel points, and I flew out to D.C. in the end of August. And I spent a long time there and took a lot of pictures. And I discovered there was a traveling show. And so for 3 months in the early part of 2013, they were in Seattle at the EMP. And it was really cool because, as luck would have it, my son was getting married in the middle of that period. Right? So I was going to have a whole bunch of relatives come. So for entertainment, the day before the wedding, I took the whole family, you know, 3 dozen people, to EMP so I could show them the Art of the Video Game exhibit, which covered 20 platforms, and the first one was the Atari video game. The C64 is in it, the Atari computer is not. It's okay, the Amiga isn't either. But it was okay, it was fun. I've got an Amiga. I'll fool with it. It has all these features. So I don't, you know, getting something that retro users can use and that has life behind it, make it open source, whatever. Even if I wind up reprogramming a Mist, that would be fun.
Are you aware of, a few years ago, Jerry Ellsworth did a C64 and a joystick?
I met her.
All right. And she did basically the same sort of thing for the C64.
Right.
Yeah,
the C1. Right. Yeah. It's pretty amazing.
Right. Yeah, I met her at the Amiga event last July. So we're connected. So, yeah. And like I say, Kurt Vendel thinks he has access to the Verilog for the other Atari computer components. And if there's some stuff missing, I can basically take the machines apart and home out the connections and reconstruct the schematics. Yes?
Would you do an all one chip type design, or would you reinvent each?
Well, probably two. You know, probably you'd have a big FPGA, and then you'd have a big memory chip, right? Because why make a memory on an FPGA? What you do is, right.
That's what people talk about, like, making a Pokey, making a GPIA.
Right. Well, I believe that I could define a system which incorporates the 6502 and the Antic and the Amiga and the Pokey and the PIA, all that stuff, and then coming out would be all the stuff to talk to the video and the audio and the SIO. And then an address and data bus going to commercial memory parts. Two pieces. That should do the job, I think. But right now I'm just talking about it because I haven't had the time to fool with it yet. It's just something that's been bursting out of me. Anyway, next slide. I can imagine coming back here and saying, here's what I'm proposing to do, because this is a local, a drivable or trainable Atari club that I can come and talk to. Because I'm not aware of a similar one in Seattle, and I'm not going back to the Bay Area. Okay, engineering work. I got to assemble the specs. I would come and present them, collect all the pieces, and make sure I got them all, and reconstruct the stuff that I don't have, and like do the Verilog for the circuit board. Thank you very much for the schematic. Add options in how would I do this. Okay, so Lotharek has already built something that talks to SD drives. Might want to build a separate SD driver and write new code for the Atari BIOS that knows about it directly. Because the nice thing about the Atari BIOS is it's very nicely designed from the application standpoint. And just redirect D.
Someone's already done an SIO with an SD.
I know. I've got them.
Do we want to take a quick break and have some pizza?
Let me stop here. Yes. Yeah, they exist. In fact, I've got pictures of them that I'm going to show later. But and then add USB as an option, because there's a lot of overlap between real USB and SIO. I am not one of the someone. Some foolish person has said that I invented USB. That's not true. At least 36 people contributed to USB. I'm one of those 36 people. But one of the interesting things I discovered recently is there have been some lawsuits over various aspects of USB, and pointing to the SIO invalidated somebody's claims because the SIO is prior art. Right. So at minimum, I think it needs disk and it needs I/O expansion, and determine if it's all can be done on the MIST platform, right? The MIST platform has USB host already in it. Somebody else, we could take, there are lots of ways we could hook up SD disks to it, and we could conceivably build take an existing part from Atari Max, which has USB in and SIO out, probably reprogram the MIST platform and the hardware already exists. Right? Kurt thinks he's got access to all that stuff and maybe collaborate with the Polish guy. Anyway, stop. Okay, so I got these ideas. I can guess that some of the people in this room might want to read the book. Maybe they'd fool with the code. If I were to build a re-implementation of the PCS, either new hardware, this guy who just walked out says, yeah, I can connect you to the Kickstarter people. That would really do well. Maybe. Maybe it needs to have four ports and the cartridge connector and all that, so if you can get hold of the old code by whatever means, it'll still work. If enough people cared, it'd be worthwhile to build a small business to create and ship this stuff. Another way to do it would be to take the MIST system, which I've ordered, which is apparently more than powerful enough, but doesn't have all the right ports on it, and find a way with existing hardware or new hardware to pull it all together. Example, The MISC system has USB on it, but it doesn't have SIO. Okay? But from a separate source, from Atari Max, I have a little USB and SIO on both sides. So I could presumably reprogram the MIST to give it redirected SIO. And I can also reprogram USB ports to, there's a company that sells things called 2600 adapters, and they're used now if you're gonna emulate Stella, let's say, on a PC, and you wanna have the classic controller experience, plug in these USB connected adapters, right? Plug in a couple of those.
Those are dirt cheap.
Oh yeah, right, I've got a couple of them at home, right? So, or do a new design that has all that stuff built in, less software hacking and more hardware hacking, but it could be done. Question is, does anyone care? You know, what have I got? Dozen some odd people in the room? Who would invest any money at all to have one of these if it was available besides him? Okay, some fraction of the room. Good.
I missed half the presentation, so I'll come
on. Just raise your hand.
Just raise your hand.
The idea is,
I'll buy your.
I've worked on all this stuff. I got a lot of stuff in my head. I want to get it down and out and available to the world before I forget it or before I get run over, because Dave Needle died and Bill Wilkinson died. Jay Miner died 22 years ago, and some of the brain trust isn't going to be around. And I'm interested in not simply, you know, helping museums. I'm interested in actually putting tools in the hands of the people that care about this stuff. And this crowd is a drivable example. That's what I'm looking at. So if I start working on these things, like I would come down to the next one of these and talk about what's the state of the book, maybe any demos I've written in the next 3 or 4 months, and whatever I've learned about the specifications for a new implementation of our favorite hardware. All right? That's what I'm thinking about. And my next question would be, if you had one, would you use it to write new games? Would you use it to write other applications? What would you do with it?
All of the above.
All of the above. Okay, well, that's a fair answer. Next slide. Okay, I want to talk a little bit about Bluetooth hit ports. Okay, so you just held up, next slide. You just held up, pull that back up again.
Okay.
Yeah. This guy. Okay, so if you get a 2600 emulator running on your PC and you want to have the classic game experience, what you do is you get one of these or two of them and you plug in your game controllers on the other end. This goes in on USB, right? So I'm thinking, we all carry monster computers in our pockets disguised as phones. And I'm 100% sure that if you can't buy an emulator today that runs under iOS, that someone could create that in a fairly straightforward way. Same for Android. This is a Windows phone, probably no one cares. And the reason I still carry it around is partially loyal to my old friends and partially because it's less likely to attract hackers' interest. They're going to hack Android and iOS before they're going to bother with Windows phones. What?
Microsoft has even said it's a buying platform.
I know. A friend of mine used to be the vice president of this stuff 12, 14, 15 years ago. Her name is Susan Del Benny. She's now a congressperson for the 1st District in Washington State. She's long out of Microsoft. She still represents me politically, but she doesn't mess with it anymore. Okay, so here's these things here. And these things, they have a USB port, which is an input, not an output. So suppose I wanted to have the classic gaming experience, not on a PC that comes with a USB port on it, but on a tablet that doesn't have USB out, or on a phone that never has a USB out. Yeah?
You'd be amazed how many phones have close to it.
Huh?
You would be amazed at how many phones have close to it.
Well, some of them have on, they're just starting to add on the go. We invented on the go in the early '90s, but it's just finally getting traction in the phone space.
The last four phones I've had have had it, and most Apple has it too.
Are they Samsungs?
One's a Sony and the other one's a Samsung, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, but all these phones have Bluetooth Low Energy. And I was one of the authors of Bluetooth Low Energy. I know it stone cold. So, what I would like to see, if it doesn't already exist, because it might already exist, is a USB low energy equivalent of this that's got basically an antenna and a battery and a little controller and a 9-pin connector. And you get two of these in it, you put them on your Android tablet, and you run an emulator on your Android tablet, and you can play classic video games. Now, there are two versions of the retro Atari game machine. There's the Flashback 2, which is based on an FPGA and has wired game connectors. And then there's the Flashback 5.0, which I own a copy of, but I haven't reverse engineered it yet. It has wireless connectors. Are those game control wireless game controllers, are they already Bluetooth?
I think they're infrared.
No, they're not infrared.
There's a couple of flash. I have a Flashback 2, but there's a few out of that, one before, and are they all different?
Well, I have a 2 and I have a 5. The 2 is based on an FPGA. I actually own the prototype now. And it's FPGA based and it's wired.
I think everything after is emulator.
The 5 is emulation. And it has wireless game controllers. My question is, what does it use as the wireless link? It's not infrared, but I don't know what it is. Huh? Well, I need to reverse engineer it. If they do it already, then the solution's in hand. If they don't do it already, and it doesn't exist anywhere else, because I need to do some research to find out whether they exist or not, I think that connecting emulators on phones and tablets to that would be quite interesting. I've batted this idea around, and people who don't know that they exist have said they're interested in helping to work on it, like Kurt Vendel. But that means I just haven't looked very hard yet, because people are doing interesting stuff all over the place.
I think what you'll find is probably 2.4 gigahertz per year, but no deal. It's the whole North NRF24
stuff. Okay.
Yes, sir?
Actually, I'm curious, would people here want a wireless controller, or do they prefer to use plastic controllers that plug into the standard port?
Well, what I'm talking about here is, if I've got an iPad,
mm-hmm.
and it doesn't have USB on it, right, and I want to play nice big display,
right,
and because it doesn't have USB, that will work, but it speaks Bluetooth, it speaks Bluetooth,
sure,
low energy,
sure.
It speaks Wi-Fi for all that matter.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm trying to bring the classic game controller feel experience to broader audience.
Got it.
That's the interest. Although there's another problem that comes up. So, I need to reverse engineer this thing. Next slide. But it brings a different problem to the fore. When I bought the prototype from Kurt, he mentioned copyrights. Because the Flashback 2 has 40 games built into it. Somebody else owns the copyrights. There was complicated negotiations for the copyrights for those games. Right? So, patents have expired, copyrights are still active. So, what do you do if you want to get access to the games? We could make a market, if you will, for something that allows you to capture the image. That could be Bluetooth connected or USB connected. So, like, if you got this collection, well, those are all wrapped up in plastic, but I've got boxes of old VCS cartridges and smaller boxes of old computer cartridges in my lab. Make something that's USB connected so I can plug in the old cartridge and suck the ROM down. Make an image of it and then put it in my emulator. Or email it to myself so I can pull it off the email on my iPad and then play it some fashion. Follow what I'm saying? There's a question about how do you capture it? There is plenty of precedent for if I buy a CD of some music, I rip it on my computer, I play it on my computer, I still have paid somebody for that. Right.
Format shifting.
Flip side, okay? So I joined this band a few months ago, and I'm their bass player. This is why I have blisters on my fingers. And of the songs we've been playing, 7 of the 12 songs are ones that I didn't know in December. So I've been going to a place called Silver Platters and buying the CDs of all the music that we're going to play that I don't own the original of in some form. So I went and bought Superstition by Stevie Wonder a week ago because I hadn't paid for a copy of that in some form. So as an honest guy who worked for a company that depended on intellectual property like Microsoft, I thought it was my responsibility to go buy a legitimate copy of Superstition, which I can then rip and put onto my phone, but to have it, right? Flip side of that, I need to respect the copyrights of the people who wrote all that code, right? So it can be USB connected or Bluetooth connected to get it into some form, and I would want to support VCS cartridge ports because a lot of us play games, and VCS cartridge ports because that's what I'm trying to support. So that is actually more interesting. And I think I could probably take any hobby computer that can be a USB device and program it to read ports. The most interesting part is doing the mechanicals. Yeah?
Quick question. At one time, did you guys ever consider doing backwards compatibility with the VCS? With the VCS?
That was a discussion that we should have had in 1976 going into 1977 because there was a discussion, and I don't remember who was all in the meeting. I was told about the results. The question was, shall we have a 30-pin connector for the cartridges so we could bring up more address lines and read-write in phase two and buy a 6502 in the original 40-pin package rather than a shorter one? That would have cost us 50 cents for the connector and 50 cents for the chip more. This is at a time when the entire bill of materials for the VCS was about $60 in 1977 dollars. Okay? You know, $200 retail in those days would be more like $1,000 now or more. Right? So that was an expensive system to have at the time. And we had a brain fart and didn't realize that we didn't understand how the market was going to brand us as the games company. And so we're out there selling VCSs and convincing. We thought on average people might buy 3-4 cartridges apiece. They bought dozens each. So we were training the market to buy collections of our software embedded in ROMs. If we had been willing to spend the dollar extra in 1977, we could have evolved the design, had a roadmap that led to a computer rather than a clean break. And as I mentioned to some people, Warner came in late 76, and they spent $28 million and of which half ended up in no one's hands. I think this distracted him for a while, and we missed a really essential, at least in, from a retrospective standpoint, that's something really important that we missed. Because then Atari fumbled like crazy. I mean, we should have planned on something like the 7800 right away as part of the roadmap, rather than reinventing that later after we had done the 5200 and the 400 and 800 and all these other things. Because if we had done that, then when, if you sold all that software to people who have the game machine, and you sell them a computer that'll play their software, you've locked them in and they'll keep buying your design. But if it's not compatible, then the computer is a completely new sale from the sale of the game machine, so they can get anything. You follow what I'm saying? I mean, this is, in retrospect, this is a huge mistake that we made, and it's way too late to fix it.
I think it's worth mentioning, just, you know, adding a current generation version of what you're talking about. I can think of about 10 people off the top of my head who went with an Xbox One, even though there's a more powerful PlayStation 4, because Microsoft unlocked that backwards compatibility and recompiled the games to be working for the Xbox One. And I'm including myself in that, too.
Right, so you're an example of somebody who has invested in the collection of games. Mm-hmm. And so that changes your next investment in console because of the backwards compatibility. Intel wrote the book on this and won it big time. When they made the jump from the 8080 family to the 8088, they made sure that you could take source code and recompile it or reassemble it. It wasn't object code compatible, but it was assembly code compatible to jump from the 8-bitters to the 16-bitters. And that was huge, because that means that you could take CPM from the late 70s and recompile it and make CPM 86, which is what Digital Research did. And MS-DOS is basically a lookalike of CPM 86, right? And that was huge for moving bunches of developers from one platform to the next. And Apple had this in a different way, because they did different versions of the iOS, or the Mac OS. They're originally 68K based, then they became RISC based, and then they became Intel based. But they at least kept the APIs the same. So, you know, they'd have to rebuild the drivers, recompile the drivers in the operating system, but they didn't have to. That means it was easy for people to recompile the applications on top of the operating system APIs. You follow what I'm saying?
Yes.
So that's about keeping the developers happy, because the developers are proxies for the end users.
It's also contributed to the last generation still, because there are still some games for the last generation that I haven't played yet that I want to eventually play. You know, now I can buy and play them on my Xbox One.
You understand. You really do. You all follow that? Because that's an important point.
Do you think the industry understood that back in the late
70s? No.
It seems like everybody's jumped to a new
thing. No, no, no. The idea that you needed to have a roadmap was one that we Atari didn't think of, because we'd sort of taken our eye off the ball. Of course, we thought that the 2600 was only going to sell for 3 years. We thought that a memory map based system was going to overwhelm it eventually. We knew our competitors wanted to do this. The Channel F was inferior and wasn't, that competition was blown away. But the television, the C64 that came in the early 80s, there are lots of other machines that had more memory that would have tried to have blown away the 2600. And we were rushing to get the second system out, because we wanted to beat our competition to that space. The good part is we had the name, and the bad part is we were walking away from people's existing game install base.
This seems to be like everybody, Commodore, TI, everybody's getting the system that isn't proud of it.
Yes, most of them did, and that was done a lot later. Someday, the Smithsonian sells this giant book called The Art of the Video Game, and it covers 20 platforms. And if you look through that, in few examples, is something that runs on one platform run on anything else. In fact, one of the lessons that we got out of the 2600 is, well, we do need to build up support. Well, with the 2600, we were thinking, we'd like to own that. We weren't publishing how it worked. Other people did it themselves. But later, the hardware developers thought, well, we need to build an infrastructure. We need to have. So we designed the Atari computer explicitly to support third-party development. And we supported Day Ray Atari. We supported huge manuals about how all that system works, right? Because the Atari game developers from the 2600 hadn't yet gone up and started Activision or Imagic and made Atari afraid of losing their revenue.
I had heard that Atari did not release the operating system and such, develops a quote-unquote development against the third-party developers for fear that it would be copied and misused or copied. So I think there was
Go back and look, because I've got large sets of documents that are copyrighted from the late 70s. These are things that Atari published and shipped for developers. And I should go find out what the dates are.
Kevin has interviewed quite a few people that have said, all of what we did, we had to learn on our own.
I've spoken to many people, and it seems like at first Atari was really trying to keep the developer information close to the chest. They wanted if you wanted software, you'd go to Atari for it. They didn't realize the importance of the developer community.
Right.
And so after a couple of years of that, they released Day Ray Atari. They came out with the demo packs that told how to do things. They launched Atari Program Exchange. And so they saw the light and turned around. But it was...
They were of more than one mind about that. And when the Activision guys left, that scared the crap out of them. And for the wrong reasons. Because you can't really... As Bill Joy several times put it, Bill Joy and I were buddies in graduate school in 1979 at Berkeley. He said, you should design your company on the assumption that not all the smart people in the world work for you. And that's a lesson that Atari missed, that IBM and Wintel understood very well. And Apple eventually had to learn that too. The Apple II was designed for lots of people to add lots of value on top of it, and then Jobs kind of got afraid because he wanted to control some things. So they took all the slots out of the Apple, there were slots in the Lisa, but there were not slots in the Mac. And then while he was gone, they did a version of the Apple Mac line with slots. And then as soon as he came back, he killed all those projects. Anyway, I'm digressing. I'm not sure when you're done. Anyway, I think something that makes it easy for people to capture their own intellectual property from a physical cartridge into something that they can run on some other thing, there's some point to that. And I would like to see that supported in the eventual system.
I don't know how it's connected. Within the last week or two, floating around social media, there's a little, for lack of a better word, a little docking station that your phone sits in, and it's an Nintendo Game Boy.
Hybrid
cartridge slot. Was that hybrid?
Hybrid.
Okay. So
cool.
It's got controls on the front and some sort of.
People are, if I'm having these thoughts, I'm probably not the only one having these thoughts.
There's a system in Japan that plays Sega, plays different variations, Master, Mega Drive, Master System, plays Game Boy, Game Boy Advance, it plays Super Nintendo.
White box.
Right. Well, what you do is you put the cartridges in it, and you have an SD card in the back, and it dumps them to the SD card, and then you go ahead and make the machine portable. You unplug a small brick.
Okay.
That's the system.
Okay.
The rest of it is just a USB interface for the cartridges.
These all sound familiar. Let me keep moving.
You're fine on time.
Okay. So those are ideas. Now I want to tell you a little bit about what I've got, and then take more questions. Next. Okay, so I got a bunch of VCS hardware, as you can imagine. It's part of my portfolio, right? So I've got, actually I've got two heavy sixers and one heavy four. I mean, heavy four guys. And then I got one of these little minis. And I've got a Harmony card, which is SD into that. I've got a two, I've got five, I got the prototype now, and I've got this interesting thing called a magic card. I've got a photographic two down. This was important because the guys who started Activision left about the same time that it's an unconnected company, reverse engineered the 2600, they built this little card with keyboard controllers on it that basically publish how it works. So I've got all that stuff. Doing development on the 2600 is not great interest to me. Many, many people have mastered that. Atari Age is still supporting them. Ed Fries is still doing new stuff. You know, that's great. I'm going to add value where other people haven't been treading. Next slide. So that's what the Flashback 2 prototype looks like. Big Xilinx FPGA. Next. So, take a 2600, you plug this thing into it. It's got some RAM, a big PROM, and a couple of interface parts. And you can wire, there's a diagram in the book that explains how to connect it to a cassette. So you can use this to generate, use a 2600 itself to do tiny game development on it and then save it to a cassette and then load it back off the cassette. Yes, sir?
Question about that. Like, you developed all this and the redeveloper comes along as well.
Somebody else developed that. I didn't.
Okay, well, I said, like, one of those Harmony cards or something like that.
No, this is radically, this kit, the thing I'm describing was put on the market, very small market, in 1981. What they were doing from a legal standpoint is proving to the courts that somebody else other than people who used to work at Atari reverse engineered the system and then published hardware and software that demonstrated how it worked. Because I got to testify in that case for 2 days. Al Miller met and married one of the court reporters. They're still married. Anyway, so take this thing and then you take the two keyboard controllers, you stick them together and you put their overlays on them, and these are basically controls for the little magic card. I have this at home, I didn't bring it here. All right, next slide. Big list! All my PCS hardware. I got three of the big ass original 800s with all the memory. I've got a 400 that I bought from Paul here with 48K with the nice cover on it. I got a 600 XL that I bought at PRGE a couple years back. I got an 800 XL that I bought earlier. I bought, have this thing in the original packaging. I've got one old 410 tape. I've got one old 810 diskette. I've got two 850s. They haven't been doubled or anything, but I got them. I got one 825 printer. I've got one 850, you know, three, four serial and one printer port on it. I've got a separate thing called an MPP printer port. It was designed somewhere here in Oregon. I've got an Atari peripheral emulator, the serial version, and I've got a USB version that I bought recently. I've got a handful of Atari Max stuff. I see there's a somebody over here has got one of these, a secret compact flash. I've got this 8 megabit flash, and I've got a USB card, which is apparently for expanding I.O. I've got a SIO2 SD. There's an example over there. And I've got a 5200. So I have a lot of stuff occupying space in my lab. Next slide. Okay, that's what my workstation looks like. And this here, I brought a copy of, this is the manual and a PROM burner. So if you had taken apart a PCS cartridge and put in a socket, you could burn PROMs and stick them in there and run them. And so that's what it'll do. And I'm going to try to use emulators as well as hardware for writing and testing the code, because I want to make sure that what I create will run on an emulator and run on the hardware. And then make the stuff open source. We'll have to figure out where we're going to host that later, but yeah, we'll get in there. Next slide. Okay. I've seen one of these here. This is the guy with compact flash. This is something that's with an internal 8 meg flash. This is something with a USB port on there for talking to kid devices. Here's a serial SIO peripheral adapter, and here's a USB pass-through peripheral adapter emulator. Anyway, lots of hardware. Next, if anybody wanted me to bring him down the next time, I could. That's what I got. I've got an Amiga 500. I've got three Amiga 2000s, one of which doesn't work, but I need to replace the battery and carefully clean it. Maybe I can get it to work. I've got two 68030 accelerator cards for them. I've ordered one of these, but it hasn't showed up yet. I look forward to experimenting with that. Next. So, based on what the website says, here's what the box looks like. Got SD card, some controls, a couple of game ports. The USB stuff is on the back, and video connectors are on the other side. It's a re-implementation by this Lotharek guy of the Amiga 500. It's based on, that's where you get it from, it's based on the MiniMig open source hardware website. Anyway, I very much look forward to playing with it. Next slide. Okay, near the end, resources and contact information. Next. If you've been saving questions, this is the time.
So I had a question on Colleen chipset.
Yeah.
You talked about 40-bit package being sort of a restriction.
That was the biggest package you could buy at the time.
So when it came to designing that, was there, or what was the thinking behind cost control? Was it die area? Was it development time? Was it
all of the above. And remember, this is all hand done. I mean, we didn't have automatic rules checking anything. We had light tables with fluorescence behind them that were about 10 foot square. And we'd print out all the layers and we'd put them on top of each other and we would manually look. This was very labor intensive. And one of the things that happened, we were doing, fortunately the first version of the TIA for the game machine worked the first time. We did three chips for the second machine, and just before Thanksgiving of 1978, we had samples of all of them. Two of the three worked perfectly the first time. The Antic had a serious bug in it. And what we did is we put it back on the table and we're looking. I had experience in college with dissect scopes and putting little tiny electrodes in eyes of frogs and shit like that, right? So I could handle this very fine-grained stuff when they were still large enough to see, because they were like 5 micron features, not 20 nanometer features. So you can almost see them, right? So I write diagnostic code that, I actually wrote a lot of diagnostic code, because this is an aside, but it's an important aside. Any of you who do hardware design have to design not only that it actually works, but that you can produce them in volume economically. And a mistake that Atari made with the Pong chip was the first Pong chips weren't designed for testability at all. Basically, you'd have to plug it into the tester and virtually play the whole game, which took several minutes. That made testing these chips very expensive. And you go back and you think, okay, theory for testability. Every internal node, every internal state has to be observable and has to be controllable. So when we were designing the three chips, we put the schematics up on the wall and say, if I do this thing, can I control that node? And if I do this thing, can I observe the state of that node? This is before they developed what was called level sensitive scan. Anybody ever heard of that? Okay, something that happened, it was invented in the late 70s, but we didn't do it at Atari. But Intel used this on all their big processors. They would have a couple of extra test pins, and they would have a very long shift register that ran all over the place, and you could hit one node, and the state of the shift register would be loaded into the internal state. So they could put the chip in a known state and then run it. And then they could halt the chip and pulse another pin, and all that state got loaded into the shift register, and they could pull back out of the chip the state that it was at. Yes. Yes, right. So this was all invented in the late 70s, early 80s. We didn't have this at Atari, but what we did do is put the schematic up on the wall, and we would mark it up in different colors when we could test, when we could control it, and we could observe it. And we didn't stop until we'd gotten everything observable and controllable. And this was really crucial, because when we built the chip and one of them didn't work, we had to go modify the code and narrow in on where the problem was. And it turns out that we were going around, imagine that you've got a bunch of little quarter inch colored dots, and you peel them off and you put them down when you see a problem. You peel it off and put it down when you see a problem, right? Well, we had put one of them down on top of another problem. So imagine here's a feature that goes like this, and here's a feature that goes like this, and they're actually touching at the corner. And we put down a little dot on top of it. So it didn't work. But I was able, in a week's worth of heavy, intense labor, to figure out exactly where the problem is. And then I went down with one of these dissect things, and I carefully sliced that little piece of aluminum. Chip worked. So we fixed it, and we knew that it was going to work the next time, so we had to go turn around and get the next chips done. And fortunately, it was just the metal mask fix. It wasn't in the deeper layers.
That was the answer?
Yes. Anyway, back out of that. Yeah.
When you have the TTL cards and the Lenovo racks for prototyping, did you guys have software that ran on those that you could swap out?
Well, the software ran against the TTL emulation, and then you would swap in the target chip. And if we hadn't been able to figure out by all of our other probing what could get it to act the way that it did, we would have then gone back to the wire up prototype and see if we could induce a defect that acted the way it did without starting a fire. Yeah. Hearing none, it's what, a little after 8?
Did you do any development on the...
What?
Did you do any development on the 1400 or 1450?
No. I left in June of 1979. Oh, and one of the reasons I wanted to leave is Atari had gotten rid of Bushnell at the end of 78. And they installed this guy, Ray Kassar, who had come from the fabric business. Ray Kassar believed that we should sell computers in designer colors so that women would buy them. Most of the women who worked in engineering with it were gone within a season. And Jay was gone in a month. But I was committed to the success in manufacturing of the product, so I stuck around writing production test code, because you want good yield in the factory. You know, write code that can tell whether all the passives work and all the chips pins are good and stuff like that. You know, how can you prove that I worked on that stuff until the day I left. But I had left because I also wanted to start a new business, and the new business would be focused on communications and networking. Because I had been reading about the French Minitel system, and I thought the future is not just in home computers, the future is in communications. Which was because the French Minitel was prototyping the internet 2 decades before they became popular with, you know, Windows Explorer and all those other things. Anyway, so I had seen the future at that point, and so I stuck around to finish the job for production and then left. So I had nothing to do with the other stuff. True story, though. You know how the originals were built, right? They have Faraday cages in there, right? You could drive a car over an old 800 and the circuit boards would all survive even if the plastic was crushed, right? They were that strong because the FCC had very tight limits, type 1 and type 2, because we were hooked up to this little thing that was hooked up to an antenna on the back of the TV. If we didn't do a good job of RFI, we'd be putting stuff, your computer screen would appear on your neighbor's sets. Right. This was a romp room no-no, as we used to say. So when we were designing the computer, we really, really wanted to have slots like the Apple II had. But they didn't. You couldn't buy a computer with an RF modulator in it from Apple. You had to buy it from M&R Enterprises. Right, so they postponed the FCC problem. The FCC started noticing that these things radiated like crazy. But we were building very tight machines. Now, I met this guy from Texas Instruments, sales rep, and he was selling fiber optic cable with an optical transistor on one end and an LED bonded it on the other side. So basically I can take a relatively high frequency signal and just send it fiber optic. And I thought, hey, gobs of isolation. Maybe I can design a machine that drives the fiber to the little guy that sits on the back of the TV set, and there's no high frequency anything going on in that little box. I just have to power it and stick it on the TV. Right? So I said to the TI guy, here's what our requirement is, here's what we'd like to do, come back to us and tell us what you think. Well, two things happened. One of them is my buddy's boss, Wade Tumas, said, no, the FCC is not going to let us get away with that. And then TI gave that, we didn't know that, but TI was working on the 99/4. And they came up with their first version and had that idea in it. I didn't think it was worth patenting. In fact, it turned out it really torched them because they brought the thing out in 1979 or close, and the FCC said, absolutely no way. The Speaker of the House of Representatives, Jim Wright, was based in TI's home district. He was their congressman. And I mean, he was there, they'd bought him, right? And he's the Speaker of the House. And they can't move the FCC. So the FCC costs TI a year to market because they have to re-engineer the thing. Now, they came out with the new Class A and Class B rules there in 1979. Now, it took Atari 3 years, I think, to get around to re-engineering the 800 to the 800XL, 600XL. Cost-reduced, simpler shielding family. In fact, we could probably have gotten away with designing something with a bus right away, but we didn't. It's sort of like we didn't know what we were going to do. But then, before I left Atari, Wade Tuma pulled me into his office when the FCC smashed TI, and he says, if you'd been trying to screw TI, you could not have done a better job. Thanks, Wade. Okay. So, yeah.
I have a question that's kind of related to what you were talking about. You have to put it back. So,
It's okay,
but
you just don't know.
Well, so you talked about how the FCC changed the rules.
Because they were noticing the rules that applied to them before. So the FCC realized that all these RF active things needed to have their own regulations, which is where the new Class A and Class B rules come from. Now, the Type 1 and Type 2 stuff, we had to be minus 60 dBm. That means basically 1,000 times lower than a decibel. I'm sorry, 1,000 times lower than a milliwatt per megahertz, which is really low. The Class B rules are minus 41.3 dBm, which is a factor of, you know, much larger. Still, it took Apple 3 years to engineer and re-engineer and re-engineer the Apple line to meet those rules. And they finally built versions that didn't have slots in them, the 2E.
Yeah, this is why the shielding on an 800 is a quarter inch thick.
Yeah, it's more than a millimeter thick. I mean, it's a Faraday cage, man. That's, they're really, and cams like them because they're so damn quiet.
On a side note, when Intel was doing the building on cartridges until they reached 800 megahertz, as they discovered that the cartridges have all these nice little antennas on them that have full interference. And the FCC rule says you cannot prevent interference, so you must be able to accept it if it is available, if it's there.
Right.
So they went away from the cartridges down to the chips again, on the sockets.
As an aside, in 2000, in the summer, so I'm on my way out of Microsoft, but I discovered they had a job opening in the Xbox team, and I read the 0.75 version of the Xbox spec, and I said, I was interviewed, I said, you know, you've got this CPU, you've got a 128-bit wide 200 megahertz double clock bus, from the CPU to the GPU, graphics programming thing, right? That's going to make radiation like crazy. And you're going to have to shield that. And the shielding is going to constrain heat. So that's going to run hot. Unless you do a good job of sucking the heat out of that in some fashion, those chips will run so hot that they could get irrevocable hardware failures. You know, stuff actually starts melting and moving. And I was basically predicting the red ring of death.
It's also Rohloff's skill.
What?
Rohloff's reduction of hazardous substances.
That's true, but what I'm talking about here is I interviewed at Microsoft, and I was predicting the red ring of death, and I was predicting, but not calling it that, and saying you need to make changes in this design. Microsoft thought of it as a vehicle to sell software. But I said, this is a consumer product. How is it going to survive? And what are the customers going to think if your return rate's bad? Well, they got it. And not only did they get it once, but they got it a second time. I have three sons. All three of them went to some trouble to acquire Xbox 360s. And all three of them had the red ring of death. All three of them did. And 5 or 6 years ago, I was at an IEEE barbecue in downtown Bellevue, and I ran into a guy who worked on the Xboxes and hardware. And he said that they spent $1.83 billion dealing with the Red Ring of Death on the first and second versions of the Xbox. And what didn't surprise me was how big the number was. What surprised me was that he knew the number to three significant digits. And I'm thinking, I could have saved him an awful lot of money! But, you know, anyway, I had, as an aside, my first wife had left me 20 years ago. So I spent the second half of my Microsoft career being a single dad with three children. When that happens, you don't work any 12 hours a day you want. You work 8 hours a day because that's all you have. And when you work that few hours only full time, eventually you fall off the bottom of their stack ranking curves. So in early 2000, they had decided that I was the scapegoat this year. So I was given a certain amount of time to interview for other jobs, but HR has got an incentive to not hire you. So I could have saved them a lot of money, but they didn't want to hear about it. So they didn't, and it cost them. If there's no other questions here, I want to pop through contacts and in memoriam. Okay, good books and articles. So I have these guys. I have this. I have these articles here. I can send you copies of some of them because I wrote them, and therefore I have the copyrights on them shared with Atari. This is in preparation. Warren Robinette is writing a book on how VCS Adventure works. Mapping the Atari, yeah. When I build code, I'm going to be depending on this book right here. These are, I guess I could download these, but I don't own copyrights, so I might have them here. Anyway, place to read more stuff. Next slide. Here's how to find me. Except I didn't put my street address on there. I'm probably going to get a job teaching in university, and I play in a rock band. Last slide.
Game of Tones.
Game of
That's
Tones.
That's nice.
I work for this guy in all three of those jobs.
Yeah.
In memoriam. He died 22 years ago in June. I was unfortunately in Geneva at the time and couldn't make it back, but I had seen him regularly. I last seen him 3 months before he died. Huh?
22.
Yeah, 1994. Yeah. Not long after Commodore went belly up. Anyway, last slide. All done. Question before for the guys who run this. The first Apple product I got was an iPad 3 or 4 years ago. My children, who at that point collectively earned more money than I did, bought me an iPad for Christmas. So I now had an Apple. I still own that Apple.
You don't do Candy Crush at the club, so we...
You know, it's interesting. As an aside, remember I told you that story about how I got the Atari job? Okay, so Christmas 1977. I bring home a 2600 in Combat, where I wrote the more than half the game. I wrote the whole display engine and whatnot, and Larry Wagner made it a more fun set of games. So I bring this home. I'm now, what, 25 years old? No, I'm 27 years old, and my brother is 15. Same brother. He still beats me on my game. Because he still has the reflexes of a cobra.
Are you aware of the glitch in Combat?
Which glitch?
When you hit the corner of one of the barriers and keep hitting the corner, you can flip-flop around.
Yes, no, that was... We discovered that problem in testing, and we decided to call it a feature.
That's very common, isn't it, with Atari? That's not a bug, it's a feature.
That's right. 20 years ago, I'm working at Atari, right? And somebody's got a Volkswagen Beetle, and the license plate says feature on it.
Not a bug.
It's just not. It was just
documented bugs.
On Facebook. That picture was going around in the last couple of days, and then the guys in the UK don't get it because it's not a bug.
Yeah, okay. Right. All right.
Who said you wrote this the invisible stuff in Combat?
That was Larry Wagner's idea.
Mm-hmm. That caused fist fights between me and my cousin.
Well, Larry is thinking, okay, I've got this game. How long? Nolan Bushnell always told us that the best games are easy to learn and difficult to master. They reward the first quarter, they reward the 100th quarter. Of course, Mike Alba's corollary is that the best games you can play one-handed so you can hold your beer or your girlfriend in the other hand. But Larry's thinking, okay, how long will it take people to master this game? How can we add more depth? So, an obvious one, since we also wrote Pong games as well, let's make the thing, you know, knock around, bounce around. In fact, one of the versions of combat is it has to be a Caron shot. If you shoot the, in some versions of the game, if you shoot the guy directly, it goes right through him. It only works if it bounces off a wall first. That's in the original, right? And, you know, for the invisible one, you're invisible unless you fire or you get hit. And if you fire, you're temporarily revealing, if you're not blinking, where you are. And if you get hit, you know, now you know where the guy is. And one of the things we did deliberately is to avoid just pounding somebody, they recoil as well as spin. We didn't have enough ROM space to have little pieces of the tank flying all over the place, right? So what we had is the tank just rotates, because we've got that graphics anyway, and it recoils away from the shot, but it recoils off to the side in one direction or the other, so that a second shot doesn't hit him. And the second shot, well, that was deliberate, because otherwise it's too easy to just start pounding somebody and run up the score and they have no chance of coming back. That's why we had the difficulty switches, right? True story. I'm 38 years old. I have a 6-year-old son. He goes off to first grade. He comes back. And I say, what'd you learn to do today? And he says, I learned to play handball. And he's talking about the big, soft things that bounce against the wall. Now, he's about this tall. I have something to show you. So I wrote, in between getting the 2600 ready to ship and diving deeply into the design of the PCS, I had some time to spare. And I had written during the VCS development, you know, let's prove that tank works and let's prove that Pong works as existence proofs. If I couldn't prove that those work, it wasn't a good enough game. So I completed, I had some time, and I said to my boss, my boss's boss, I said, how many versions of Pong do I have to create to make a viable Pong cartridge? And he says, well, 50's enough. So Video Olympics has 50 variations. You know, there's foosball, and there's hockey, and there's quadrupong, and there's a basketball game, and there's a volleyball game, and whatnot. So all these variations. But one of them was handball, where instead of bouncing back and forth, you have two on the same side. One of them flashes if they're not supposed to touch the ball, and one of them is solid when it's supposed to, right? And they're bouncing it off the other side of the ball. So I've got this game, this handball. So I go in the garage, because I haven't had the 2600 out, because I didn't need it. And I hooked it up to the TV set. By the way, when I worked at Atari, I didn't own a television set. And we'd be at the lab, and somebody would turn it to, like, a regular channel, and I'd say, look at the graphics! No, that's live. You know, it's like... But it did occur to us, I was the one, we didn't patent it, but I realized, okay, we put the same pattern on the screen all the time if it's on. We need to change the colors circularly so that we don't burn in colors. And I have a couple of copies of the Consumer Reports article from November of 1977, where Consumer Reports said that's a nice feature to have, that it doesn't burn in your TV set. Yeah. I just forgot what I was covering. But
handball.
So I'm going to play handball with my son. So we have difficulty switches. And I set it so that my paddle is this big and his is this big, because he's 6 years old and I'm 38 years old. Right? Perfectly reasonable. We put the difficulty switches in so wider collections of people could become reasonably matched. And that's what we call them, handicap switches, because that's what they do in golf. Right? So, but he's 6 years old and he has the reflexes of the couple. So the first game we play, he gets it. He's got it. Second time, we play, same difficulty, both of us. And third game, he's better than I am. Third game, he's 6, I'm 38, right? Michael, what do you think of this game? He said, Dad, this is heck of fresh. What? At that moment, I realized that I was on the other side of the generational divide. That I was one of those people over 30 that you couldn't trust anymore. Because I was like, okay, I was clear that he was happy. But it was also clear that I was now an old fogey and was not in touch with this stuff.
Well, that's kind of work that boils down to that.
Yeah, you know, although a nice thing that happened, I was, you know, he's 14, right? A few years later. And he says, Dad, you were cool once. As if at least I'm a has-been rather than never was cool. You know, that kid, he's 33 now. He wants to inherit my Stella bicycle. I still own the bicycle. It still works. And he's decided he wants to inherit it. So, anyway.
He's not cool enough.
Well, now he, it's interesting. He, Father's Day, last Sunday, I'm sitting next to him. I say, Michael, you're 33 and a half today. He said, no, Dad, don't say that. I'm so old. What's wrong with you? Get used to it. You know?
Yeah.
But, you know, he now thinks he's old at 33 and a half. And I'm like, oh, come on. I mean, I'm 65. My dad's 94. His father died at 100. So there's life after 33 and a half. Anyway, any more questions?
Have you spoken at Reverend Ann's school before?
Yes.
Last year. Yeah.
I was here, I think I was there 2 years before. There have been classic games expositions in Vegas a few times. I hate Vegas. Yeah. You can't. I will. You have to pay me to go to Vegas. I will not go voluntarily. Yeah, and I was lucky. I had never been in Wisconsin before, but I went to MGC 2.5 months ago. And that was good because I got a chance to stop for no extra cost and visit my son and my new daughter-in-law in Minneapolis. So I went out there. You know, I got to give variations in this talk and standing room only crowds, and they're like so happy. And I got to talk, I finally got to meet Marty Goldberg in person and recruit him to work on this book. That was fun. Yeah.
I have one more question.
Yes, sir.
Do you have.
Mike, right? It's Mike, right?
Mike, yeah.
My middle-aged brain is working.
Do you have faith that sometime in the not-too-distant future, software emulation can become perfect to the hardware? It sounds like in when you've been talking, you have a lot of interest in emulation. That's something that I've always been interested in myself.
I'm more interested in the FPGA from a, you know, get it to really work exactly right. You have to ask yourself, who cares and why? And one part of me wants to build FPGA emulation because it's actually logically doing the same things in parallel according to some variation of the old design. The emulators are more in terms of being able to put this into the hands of a lot of people. Market development rather than, you know, some entertainment for hundreds of thousands of people rather than a lot of entertainment for 10,000 people. I don't know. I'm interested in feeding the developers, the amateur developers, the hobby developers. You know, 100 years ago, most music was not done by professionals, it was done by amateurs. Musical instruments are tools for artists. Being able to draw, tool for artists, right? Now we have new tools for artists like being able to write video games. I would like to democratize the ability to create new games. And an example of being able to create new games The 2600 has a much larger install base. There were 30 million of them in the world at one point. But the skill it takes to create a 2600 game is pretty high compared to the skill it takes to create an 800 game, because the hardware is so much more powerful. So being able to create platforms that let kids, interested teenagers, write games and test them. You know, emulation is fun, but hardware that actually does the job is interesting too. At least it's interesting to me. And I have to master skills that I would have to teach anyway. I mean, when I was interviewing for the job at Seattle U, they wanted somebody to teach Verilog. And I'm thinking, yeah, I should be able to teach Verilog. But I can't yet. So that's on my list of things to do. Yes, sir.
What piece of 8-bit software do you, have you seen so far do you think that really pushes the hardware? Or that's utilized?
Anything it's not there? Clear to me that that's been done.
You don't think that's been realized?
Well, one of the reasons I want to do this port of Adventure is because I'm going to stress it pretty hard. I actually wrote a demo that was never released called Superbug, because there was an old coin-op game called Superbug. And Superbug had a, you know, a top-view Volkswagen rotating through 360 degrees, and it drove around a big virtual playfield. This was like, and it was, like I say, this was a coin-op game. And I wrote a version of that as a, to test the PCS hardware, and it worked. But I didn't, I somehow escaped Atari without having a listing for it, so I have to regenerate it. But doing the game I want to do for the book would cause me to reconstruct a lot of it anyway. There's a lot of games that have pushed the VCS pretty hard, and I'm not thinking simply of the stuff that does the bank selecting. I'm thinking more of a lot of the Activision cartridge kernels where they don't even use wait for sync. They have, you know, it's line for line, and it knows exactly where it is, and it's doing stuff all the way through, and it's putting up more and more stuff.
Case in point, I think that's due to the fact that 2600 has been pushed so hard, due to the fact that so many people are doing it, and they're finding, they're all communicating and finding different ways of using the hardware.
Right.
Should you realize your project with VCS, I think that would be an inevitable outcome of that.
Well, there's no, I don't think there's anywhere we're going to sell 30 million of those things, for example. But, you know, even thousands of them in the hands of, you know, as a platform that it's easy to write games on. I mean, maybe even write them on it and play them on an emulation. And you get both ends of the spectrum. I'm trying to help support the people who do their own stuff.
But I think an end result of that would be you would see better games, more creativity, and more interest in seeing the hardware realized better.
Well, let me ask you a question. People are obviously emulating the C64 family, which was an open platform. And I'm not aware, maybe somebody is emulating NES and Super NES, but those were closed platforms. So I think, you know, one of my interests in the Amiga platform, it was also an open platform, and it can do stuff that I don't know that even the SNES can do. But most of the latter game consoles were closed platforms. They had encryption because they wanted to pry money out of all the software vendors, whereas I'm specifically trying to enable all the software vendors, the hobbyists.
A lot of 2600 resurgence, I guess, for lack of a better word, boils down to availability through the quality of the development tools and having a real good debugger and cycle counter on the screen and emulation. So it's two orders of magnitude easier than problems and seeing what crashes.
Right. Yeah, really. I remember asking somebody, because they had access to a 1611, which was an HP 6502 logic analyzer that they would do disassembly on the fly. And my friend said, no, the new stuff is great for that. You don't need to need a 1611 anymore. You develop it on the emulator, and then you burn the code and run it. Something like that. People may not realize it, but you know, modern software projects are many orders of magnitude more complicated, right? Combat, 2,000 bytes. So we're talking about less than 1,000 lines of machine code. Windows 2000, the last version that I had a lot to do with at Microsoft, had 29 million lines of code in it. Now, what Microsoft has since done, and their, I imagine their competitors have done too, is they've developed tools that look at the source code and figure out how this could break so they can give advice to the developers and suggestions to the developers and then help create the test code that automates testing instead of hiring a whole bunch of people to sit in the room and try it over and over and over again. They can definitively do certain things to it and push it in certain ways and make sure that it doesn't actually fall over. So that's technology there. I'm sure that Apple does the same thing. If they don't, they're crazy, and they're not crazy. So I'm sure they do it, and most of their competitors should be. The people to worry about are the people developing little apps. Because they don't have access to this stuff, and their testing is, here, give it to someone and see if it breaks. Right? There was a period when I ran engineering at a modem company. And the people who wrote the software, the firmware worked for me, and a different bunch of people who tested the firmware worked for me. And they used to post the score, how many ROMs had been submitted and how many bugs they found, and that was a constant battle. That was pretty funny. But stepping back, my first day at Microsoft, working for Jay, he says, success has 1,000 fathers, failure is an orphan. The cynical view is it's, I get the credit and you get the blame. But the uncynical view is that business is a team sport. And all kinds of people make a difference. The people who do production quality checking, the people who do production quality assurance, make sure that the design is good and that each version that we might ship is also good. The people who take tech support calls. I'm always nice to those people. Sometimes I'm really angry with them. But I will step back and I'll say, here's the suggestion I want you to give your developers. This is an end user problem. Here's why it's a problem. Here's what they should do about it. Okay? Marketing people actually matter. Salespeople matter. Finance people matter. All the production people, everybody matters. Big circle. It's not just two guys in a garage. And I knew Woz and Jobs. It's not just the two guys in the garage. You can build an existence proof that attracts investors in a garage. You can't build shippable products in a garage. At least not hardware. Follow what I'm saying?
That's why
Well, what had happened is that Atari had created a market and seeded it with the game-playing consoles. So they had created a market which then the Activisions and the Magix could feast on because they didn't have to do the product development and shipping and production testing anymore. So Atari treated them badly. Atari was paying me, you know, $24,000 a year. They were paying some of those guys $30,000 a year, but in 1979. But still, they were paying us those guys radically less than the money that was being generated. And Ray Kassar told them that, you know, you guys are easy to replace. Not.
I heard a story that Ray had said people that assemble the cartridges are like just as good or not as good or something like that. Like there's a comparison. programmers.
That was a very foolish thing for him to say.
So it was true.
No, it's not.
No, I mean, it's true that he said it.
Well, it's true that he said it, yes. He said words to that effect. I wasn't physically present, but I've heard several different variants of it, and they all kind of overlap that way. He was a brilliant marketing guy in terms of sales, shipping, support. He understood many aspects of the business that weren't technical. Company needed somebody like him and somebody with the technical vision to figure out the next moves. He wasn't good at the latter. Of course, Bushnell was distracted when we should have been coming out with a roadmap instead of a product and then another product. We didn't. Of course, we weren't prescient enough to realize that maybe we had 3 years to do the next product instead of two. We knew that more competition was coming along, but we didn't realize how successful we were going to be. We thought that each VCS customer might buy a handful of cartridges, and they bought several handfuls of cartridges each. So it's sort of like they owned us. Except we didn't realize that they owned us, so we went up and did something different. It had the same logo on it, but it was a different thing.
Would it be reasonable to say that Nolan blew it after
that's been
he got
suggested
his money from Time Warner?
$13 million.
Yeah, he got $13 million in 1976.
Wow.
He was certainly distracted. Certainly distracted. Although we're still in touch, right? When I became a fellow, he was one of my references. And I just sent him a message recently because the latest copy of Scientific American is on the newsstands in a week. It says, Better Brains from Games. Nolan Bushnell runs a company called Brain Rush, and the purpose of Brain Rush is to create games that help us old farts keep our brains. He does this right now.
The next meeting will have Chuck E. Cheese pizza. Is that...
Oh, man. We had arguments because I used to make pizza. And we had arguments because Bushnell would say our pizza doesn't have to be that good. Because if the place is entertaining enough, people will still come in. And I said, no, you still have to have good food. Yeah. Anyway, I am now, it's 8:45. I'm glad to entertain you. But, what?
Yeah, I've got the room till 10, so 11 if I want it.
No.
But
the question I have is, should I go drink some coffee and head home tonight, spend the night in my own bed? Or should I crash on your couch and drive home in the morning?
It's not a couch, it's on the bedroom.
Oh, okay. My wife would probably stay, get up early in the morning and be safe.
Do you want to make your wife happy or do you want me to call her?
It's about keeping you safe, I guess.
No, my wife would insist on safety. She would drive safe, dear.
You can keep them both happy.
All right. So, yeah, the last thing I need is a month or two from now, I want to be back because
okay.
I've got specs I want to talk about. There's a movie I might want to share if I can get it all to work. You know. And you guys can tell me, oh, yeah, that's a terrible spec. Do that. You forgot this.
Fire a few bullets to 800.
Huh?
Fire a few bullets to 800. See if you can take it.
You can take one outside and drive over it.
No.
Actually, I have one shield all by itself left over from a. I have just the shield. We can try it. I have a shield from an 800.
So I did a little bit of that.
Okay, so in this article, there is, I took it apart enough to take a picture of that because I wanted people reading the article to get a clue what we're talking about there.
That's the heavy 600.
Well, that's a heavy 6-800 inside. Yeah. Faraday cage.
Anyway, I'm going to pack up then.